Hello everyone, welcome back to the channel. So I got another machine, this time dragged it out from way out east, from the northeast someplace. It's one of those games, yeah, I paid a little bit more than I should have like usual. It's kind of like one of my grail games, so you know, one of those games turn up, you kind of have to have them and you go the extra mile to get them. So I got it, it's already been put downstairs in the garage. You kind of saw it in one of my last videos, it was kind of sitting there. Haven't toyed with it yet, like the usual thing. Got delivered, but I was in the middle of other restoration, so it's just been sitting there. Time to go take a look at thing and power that sucker on. So let's head on downstairs and go take a look. And here we are. Yes, it is Mouse Trap, which you saw in my other videos. It was just kind of sitting there in the background, but yes, Mouse Trap. Now, I know this game may be a little obscure and some people may not know what the heck it is, but it's definitely one of those games that falls into the grail category for me anyway. You know, Robotron is probably my ultimate grail. I had to get that game. Remember when that game popped up, I drove immediately 2 hours to go get it. Mouse Trap is another one of those type of games. I just didn't really want it forever, and they're so hard to find. So I had to drag this one from all the way out east, which wasn't cheap. I ended up paying $9.50 for it. And the sound apparently doesn't work. Supposedly with this machine, the game works, it's functional, but there is no sound. And I bought it off a member on Cloud, so I'm not too worried about it. At least it's all made it here. Looks to be mostly intact. Now, Mouse Trap, for those of you who don't know, is basically a Pac-Man style game. To me, it is the best Pac-Man clone type game. I mean, there's a million of them that have been made, and I guess Ladybug, for example, is one of the more famous ones, but Mousetrap is my favorite one. It's very similar. You move around a maze, but you're a mouse, and you're collecting cheese, and you can pick up bones, which are effectively like power pills. The difference is you don't use the power pills right away. You can use them as you want. You can accumulate them and use them as you want to munch on the cats, because it turns you into a dog when you use those bones. And there's different colored gates along the way that you use to block the cats as you're going on the maze. You press these buttons to unlock the gates, three different colors. This is to use one of your bones, turns into a dog, so you can kind of turn the tables and the kitty cats, and the basic joystick and player buttons. So, yeah, that's finally another grail acquired. Now, with this game, it's not really going to be a restoration, because when I saw it in the pictures, I mean, here, let's take a look. Actually, let's take it off the... Some of it we can handhold. Actually, I'll do the side art first. So you can see as far as the side art goes, here's the thing. And now the sun is hitting it directly, so this may be... Well, actually, my light is also hitting it directly. Let me tone down my light a little bit. But the sun is blasting it, so it may look a little faded on camera, but it's not. All the color is here on this side art. The only damage, I would say, up here you see there's some damage, but the rest of the side art is intact, and the color is pretty good. And the cabinet's mostly intact. It's just filthy. So I'm like, all right, that's cool. Go around to the other side. Actually, let me move it out. It's in kind of a tough spot here. Stay there, tripod. All right, a little bit more so I can get around to the other side. Now this side is actually better than the other one. There's no real damage on it. And likewise, the color's all there. But of course, the white areas are just, you know, dirty. It's like, okay, let's take a look at the front. And over here, I think I will handhold it. Let's get it off the tripod so you guys can see what I'm talking about. I'm gonna take the plug off here so it gets out of our way. So I'll start with the marquee. Again, filthy, but notice how it's all intact. There's no names carved in it. There's no paint flaking away. It's intact and original. That's pretty cool. Let's go down to the bezel. Now, the bezel has some minor scrapes here and there, but no obnoxious words carved into it and no paint flaking. This is all intact, so that's good. The control panel, yeah, I mean, like everything else, it's just filthy as hell, but it's intact. It's not like it's peeling up or parts going away. It's all there. It's just dirty as all hell. Same with the buttons, same with the joystick. And let's come on down to the front here. Coin door areas, again, no lock bar holes, nothing like that. Just extremely dirty. And you know, you can see some kind of rust elements here, a little bit here and a little bit there, but overall, this thing is in pretty good shape. T-molding, not too bad. I mean, if I were to change anything, it may be the T-molding. I may change that, maybe. But honestly, what I'm thinking about here, mount this guy again. There we go. Honestly, I think I'm going to leave this intact. This guy is a survivor. As far as I can tell, it's all original and it's in pretty good shape. So I'm going to touch or change nothing. I mean, maybe the T-molding, but like a pink or a yellow, maybe. But even that is not sure. Everything else, I'm just going to give this thing, as far as cosmetically, I'm just going to give it a good clean. A really good clean, actually. Sometimes it's hard to tell how filthy these things are on camera, but let me tell you, it was stored in the garage, so yeah, this thing is beyond dirty. So that's it. On the outside, cosmetically, I'm just going to clean it. Nothing more. Yeah, I'm just kind of looking at it one more time. There's even little scuffs here, you know, minor ones that you can potentially, you know, touch or paint and stuff like that, but I don't even think I'm going to bother. Sometimes when you get one that's all original Survivor, it's just best to leave it alone, especially if it's in really good condition. Just clean it and let it go. So I got a whole bunch of different cleaning products in mind specifically for this one to try to bring it back to life. So that is the plan cosmetically. Now, I think the time has come to fire it up. From what he had told me, he said it works, but that there's no sound. So, let me go ahead and plug this sucker in. Apparently no sound on Exidy games is a common thing. Okay, I'm hearing humming. No idea if there's any more key, right? Let me just make sure. Oh, well, that ain't good. Let's I can kill this light here. Well, is it getting AC power? Yes. Is the game working? No, I'm just getting white, as you can see. So that's not good. Here's the thing, though. Hey, I can see mousetrap. A little bit of mousetrap burned, but not too bad. Here's the thing, though. I know these machines can break during transit. That's why I'm not hugely surprised at this. I bought a game from Orange County here, which is like 90 minutes away. It worked perfectly there. Brought it home, turned it on, and the monitor was dead. It's just from the jostling that happens during the transition. You know, things that come loose, solder joints may break, who knows. So that's possible it happened here. The guy that I bought it from on Clav has pretty good rep. He's been there a while, he sold lots of games. So I mean, I trust the guy. I'm not worried about that. So I'm sure this is just an accident of shipping. It is what it is. But that means we're gonna have to revive Mousetrap. Now before I mess it up anymore, I'm gonna just unplug it because I don't know what the problem is, so why risk messing anything else? So, okay, cosmetically we know we just gotta wash it and clean it and bathe it, and that's gonna be it. No parts to buy, I'm just gonna make it look new. Technically, it's gonna be interesting. I've never repaired a broken game before. So, games like the Joust you saw had a whole lot of problems, but the basic game worked, and I was working with that, and you know, I was fixing things as I was going. That kind of thing I've learned to do here and there. But a game that was just plain old dead like this one, a little out of my wheelhouse. Not something I've ever done. So I guess that means we'll just do it on camera, right? I mean, how hard can it be? I don't know. I'm going to figure it out. Whatever. How hard can it be? I do know these Exidy machines have problems with sound, so that's a common thing. And I've done some research ahead of time. There's a ribbon cable that tends to go bad. Maybe that's related to the sound. I don't know. But you know what? It's going to be an exploration project. So that is the plan. Cosmetically, it's going to be given a bath. I'm going to make it shine. I want it to look like as good as it can, but as a Survivor. I'm not touching any other parts. I'm not changing anything. I'm not buying marquees or bezels or nothing. And then I got to check. He left the key down in there. I have to check if the key opens everything, if it opens the back, and crack this guy open and take a look. Maybe we'll get lucky and it's something simple at the back. A cable popped out or a board came loose or something like that. Or a chip, you know, popped out. So I think that's what we'll do next. I'm going to kind of reposition this guy and then open it up and see what the heck we're dealing with. I figured I might as well just record myself doing it so you guys can see the process. So all I did is I opened up the coin door so far down here. Because there's a lock on the back and you never know with these things if they have keys or not. Let me actually put it a little further out here. Yes, so there's a lock on the back door. And it came with one key over here, so I'm assuming that opens those two. I took a look in here, but I don't see any key for the back. I mean, this is a different kind of key. I can see inside. There are boards, so that is a good sign. There are boards in there, as you can see. So there is hardware. Somewhere in there lies our problem. To be determined. But for now, I gotta figure out how to get the back off. Let's just take a look at...
I don't know where the key would be hidden. No, I think it's in the key. These are the Keeler Island shake. There's nothing here. Oh, the coin meter, 20,771. Not too much. I guess it wasn't a very popular game.
Let me see, how's your guys' view here? It's not so bad. Well,
I don't know why this machine has so many coins on it, by the way. I mean, it's got the typical one here and then the coin box below. And then it has this. Let's see if that even opens or if I have to drill. There is a key in here, but it may very well be fused in here. I think there's going to be a lot of drilling in my future. I mean, it turns this one, but the key itself does not want to come out. Okay. Well, this key, I mean, I'm going to try to use some tools and penetrating fluid or something to try to get this out, because I'm assuming that it'll open these two. Maybe if we're lucky, the key is in there somewhere, but as far as I can tell, I don't see any key. I wonder, this is a little creepy to do, to look for the control panel latch in a machine like this, because you don't know if there's spiders or, well, this thing, okay, only one of the latches was clearly installed. You don't know if there were spiders or what the heck is in there. Goodness. It looks like there may have been a squirrel or something in there. What is that?
You know, when I start seeing remnants of what looks like nuts, that is never a good sign. You guys see? Oh, well, if you can kind of see them down, this thing is stealing focus, but there's right down in that area there, there's an accumulation of food of some kind. I don't know what the heck's going on there. Oh yeah, there was something in here at some point. You can see down below. Well, oh boy, this guy's gonna need some cleaning. There is gunk down below, and it is not the arcade kind of gunk. It looks like, I don't know, food or something. What's interesting is a switching power supply. It's hard. I'm trying to film this through the control panel here, which is a little bit tight. But let me try to get the camera in here, and hopefully I don't drop it in there. So there is a switching power supply. Let's make this guy. There we go. Got some boards, harness, fuses. I want to put the camera back down. There's not a whole lot you can see here. Yeah, I'm kind of going at this blind here because I'm holding it. Let me get it out. There we go. I want to take a peek inside. If I'm lucky, maybe it'll be kind of obvious there's a key somewhere. Okay, I hit the stop on the recording button there by accident, but in case we missed it, I'm not sure which part of it got missed, but long story short, we got the control panel down, which gives me access to all the locks. I'm going to take all the locks off the doors below, just so I can free access in and out, and I'm going to throw those away. On the back of the machine, unfortunately, there is no key, so I'm going to have to drill that out. And the first order of business, well, first and second order of business is cleaning. First order is cleaning inside, and then second order is cleaning outside. I'm just going to clean. This thing is so dirty. I hate working on dirty machines, especially inside, because that's where all the grossness is. I just want to have it clean. Once this thing is clean, inside and out, then I can at least bring the machine inside and just work on it there more at my leisure, you know, and try to figure out this problem. Because, truth be told, I don't know how long it's going to take me to figure out what the hell the problem is. I'm hoping it's something simple, but again, this is a little bit out of my wheelhouse. It's not something I've ever done before, but we're going to give it a shot. So, all right, it's time to bust out all the various cleaning materials and get this thing all shipshape. I started the deconstruction process. There's not a whole lot of it, but just a little bit here and there. The coin doors are simple enough. I was able to open this one. And let's see here. This one here. This one here is an interesting one. I'll have to take it off the tripod here. But I was able to reach from the control panel because I had this flipped out. I was able to reach down and just unscrew these locks. So these two doors, it's weird, look like coin doors. They're held together by this Exidy bracket, so they kind of operate as one. And the reason is it lets you access the boards from here. And I can see little wheels and stuff, and there's a little clamp down there. I'm assuming you let go of the clamp and this whole thing should pull up. Okay, let's find out, actually. Yeah, there we go. Isn't that cool? That's what that is for. And still has some of the little instructions and stuff here. So I've removed all of them. See, this one's gone, this one's gone, that one's gone. But I'm having a little bit of a mystery. And you can see there's a little piece in the back. I thought I was going to drill out and I was all prepared to drill that lock out. But I literally just turned it by hand and the door came right out. But what's puzzling me is this. There doesn't seem to be any access from the back. That little door over there that I took out was just here, you know, for the monitor. I guess so people can work on the monitor or whatever. But this lower part is basically, it's stuck in there. It's part of the cabinet. You can't take it out. And the reason why that's confusing me is how the hell am I supposed to clean in there, access like, you know, that the little switching power slums to sideways. I mean, how am I supposed to get in there and take a look at things and clean it up? Are you supposed to do everything from the front? Maybe that's how it is. I don't know. So I'm going to keep looking, but from my immediate thoughts, it seems to be no, the back is not meant to be accessible because I can't see any way to take that lower part out. So if that's the case, in order to have room from the front, I'm going to probably remove both of these doors to give me as much room as possible to kind of get in there and access. So I'm going to keep probing around, but if I got to take out the doors, then I'm going to take out the doors because I have to be able to clean in there because this thing has all manner of filth inside. Yes, that grossness down there was inside of the cabinet. I'm trying to clean it out with vacuums and various things and basically reaching here from the inside to clean it. As you can see, it's getting better in there because it looks like my mousetrap machine actually caught a mouse. As ironic as that sounds, it does look like there was definitely a rodent in there. I still can't find any access panel from the back aside from this thing. But what I did notice is one thing. It does look like the monitor is on a tray. And you can see here, it's a piece of wood. Let me see if I lift it. You can see how it moves. I suspect you slide it all out that way. Now it's got a video signal cable here that can be unplugged. And I got a power cable there that can be unplugged and the monitor is free. So what I think I'm going to try, as far as I can tell, let's see. I think it's this whole thing here. So there's a little bolt there and there's a bolt there. I think if I take those two out, this entire monitor tray is free to slide out and I can get it out of here. And that at least give me some more access from the top. Still not ideal, but it's the only way I can think to get inside this machine because I have to clean it. There's just no way I'm leaving it this way. I do have the board slid out. I can't remember if I showed that or not, but it does slide out like this, which is pretty cool. So at least it'll... Once this thing is clean, in theory, I won't need to go to the inside. You can do all the servicing from the front. So I have heard these ribbon cables go bad, and that's often why you lose sound. So maybe that's why it originally didn't have sound. But mind you, of course, the machine doesn't work at all right now. But anyway, I'm going to sit here and get this monitor out. I'm going to try taking those two bolts out and hopefully slide this whole tray out and give myself some more access. I got those two bolts out. I just wanted to demonstrate now how this thing comes out. You can literally grab it and see how the whole monitor slides out. I still have it connected from the back, so I'm going to disconnect it, slide it out, and get this thing over there out of the way. That'll give me a little bit better access to the inside. Just setting up the camera here. May as well record myself hauling this thing out. There we go. Now, I wear gloves while I'm doing it. Not so much because of worry about electrical shock, but that's a possibility because you're going to be reaching behind there. I figure that's safer too. Because you're grabbing these edges and metal and stuff, I don't want to cut myself. So, anyway, this thing should. I disconnected both cables in the back. Okay. I should go down from right here. I don't think there's any wires, nope. Okay. And that is that. So I just put the monitor over there. Just to get it out of the way. As far as I know, that thing works. Okay, cool. This is a little bit better. Gives me some access down there now. So you know what? This thing is in the way too. I think if this control panel were out of the way, I could really lean over and clean everything, and that'll work out. So I think I'm going to be good to go. I'm going to take off this control panel too. It looks like it's the usual... Okay, now the bolts are completely loose already. Wow. Goodness. Alright, yeah. It's got three bolts and it's got a little wiring here. You can see there's two connections and they go in only one way. So yeah, I'm going to take this thing out and that'll give me full range to get in there. I'll show you what I mean. Let me get the gloves off. And let's come inside. And you can see here, for example, look at this bolt here. Completely loose already, but it's got one there, one here, and one here. And the only two cables coming to the control panel are these two. And they're the type that only go in one way. Makes my life super easy. Well, even easier, they're labeled P24, P24, J23, yeah, 23 and 20, so they're labeled. That makes it simple. So I'm gonna do that. I gotta get the control panel out of here. And then I think I should have nice, easy access to the inside. Now that's better. Now I can access the inside properly. I was trying to do it with the monitor and the control panel in place, and oh my goodness, it was getting my nerves. I was able to clean some of it, but not quite enough of it. Now, at least I can come in close and deal with it. Actually, here, let's see, so you can see the tray and all that hardware is there. Let's go ahead and slide that out. I left the clip down there open, so the thing can be all pulled out of the way. Funky. Leave it there, I guess. There we go. Now I get access to the inside. Now it looks better because I did clean some of it the hard way, but you can still see there's a... Yeah, it's still pretty gross. But at least now I can get in here a lot easier and start cleaning stuff up. It's a shame that the back door doesn't come out, but you can see it's... well, I mean, I can see it here. There's glue and all that in place. I mean, that piece of wood is glued to here and glued to the back. It ain't coming out. Some of the stuff like this is... Ew. I'm going to clean that. Cause that looks like maybe mouse... doing its thing in there. Okay. That's weird, and the switcher's all the way down there. How the hell are you supposed to even access, I guess from the coin doors. It's really tricky to access in here. I almost wonder if I should take out the coin box too. And then that should get me free, because I can't, getting underneath here will be tough. Is there a screw underneath it? Yeah, there's one underneath. I mean, the coin box is one underneath, and I did see 1, 2, and then there's 3, 4 accessible inside, and the whole coin box would come out. Maybe I may do that as well. I'll try it without doing it first, but yeah, as you can see close up here, all the damage, mandatory bent here, this one here too. But the wooden area here where the vinyl is, I guess, looks like that'll just be easily cleaned. The coin doors are a little rough. I wonder if it'd be worth painting the coin doors or just leaving, because this is a bit chewed up here. You know what? I'm going to end up having to just clean it all before I even work on repairing it. Completely clean this thing, and that'll give me a nice, you know, a base slate to look at and figure out what the heck to do. Yeah, I think that's going to be the goal. I'm going to resume my cleanup here, try to get the vacuum in here and start finishing up the rest of this guy and picking up some various pieces I see at the bottom, washers and stuff. Yeah, time to get the vacuum again. Cleanup is going okay. Definitely more access now. There's still a few little crevices I can't quite get to, like way deep in the back. Like kind of deep down between in there. I got some of it, but I can't quite reach and get everything in. Yes, there still is some... I'm going to flip it this way. It's not too bad, but there still is some stuff, shall we say, in there. And I do want to clean it out as much as I can, that's for sure. So, I mean, everyone has their ways of cleaning. I have a very scientific way that, you know, I determined from lots of research that works well for cleaning that sort of thing. It's worked well for me anyways. And that, for me, would be the leaf blower. This, I mean, you got to be careful to make sure there's no, like, papers or other things in there that you don't want getting blown away. But if I hit the back of that area with this, keep my eyes closed and hold your breath and it'll kick out dirt from a lot of those crevices and put them in places where I can finally reach them. So I'm going to do that right now just to get some of that last bits of stubborn stuff out. Whilst I was cleaning it, I went ahead and put the monitor, connected it back, because at some point I'm going to have to turn this into a makeshift testing station to figure out why it doesn't work. But I've cleaned most of it pretty good. I don't feel like I need a hazmat suit anymore. I'm still going to clean their inside, like run a little cloth, a slightly damp cloth, and to get rid of a lot of these stains and stuff like that. So I'm still going to clean it more, but all the poop and that kind of stuff is gone. I even took off the top marquee. Part of the reason is, you know, I mean, it's easier to clean the marquee that way, but I like to see all the crevices. I want to make sure I know what's going on there, especially with a machine that looks like a rodent's been living in it. And sure enough, as we come up here, we see a few things. See, there's a piece of cardboard in the back there. I guess it's used to block. This one didn't have any light, but normally there's a light here for the marquee, and it probably blocks some of the light from going down to the bezel area. But I see this. Actually, I'm gonna have to hold it sideways. You guys see what I see there? In the end of that thing? Munch, munch, munch. Someone has been nibbling on that cardboard. And I'm gonna say it is most likely this guy right here, or one of those, was in there nibbling. So, yeah. At least he's gone. What are you gonna do? One odd thing, I mean, aside from it also being filthy in here, it's holes for two speakers, and you could see it underneath here. You know, it's set up for two speakers, but there's only one hooked up. And here they just put a piece of cardboard, but the mounts are there. I wonder if we could put two speakers, or this is how it's supposed to be. I don't know. Kind of interesting. But anyway, I will continue the cleanup. I mean, most of the major cleanup is done, and I got the monitor hooked up. But I'm going to go on the inside, and all the inside surfaces of the cloth, and just start kind of getting it nicely, really nicely clean. And then we'll start cleaning the cabinet soon as well. Yeah, let me do that first. Get the inside done before I even start tackling the electronics. I mean, I'll be honest, I don't even know where to start for the electronics. I'm half hoping this thing will just work when I turn it on, because I've never repaired a dead game before. But, well, whatever. I guess I'm going to have to figure it out. So I'm going to continue some cleanup here. I couldn't help myself. I ended up, you know, powering it on to see if it would work, and I was still getting that white screen. So I powered it off, and I kind of went through that. I just kind of took out... There's various connections on here. Let's get this thing all... So what I've done is there's various connections. I was supposed to keep cleaning the thing, but I was just kind of curious to see what's going on. While I was in here, I tested a few things. Let me see. What are we looking at here? Here we go. I checked voltage on the bulbs. I mean, they're incandescents. They still work, but they're 5 volts. I was just curious to know. I tested it. These guys are 5 volts. I'll change those out when I have time. What I ended up doing is every connector here, I just kind of unplugged it and plugged it in. I don't know if that'll make any darn difference, but who knows. But I did put in a little voltmeter just to check a few things. The switching power supply is way down there. It was a pain in the ass to check, but it is indeed getting 5.3 volts off of the 5 volt line. Then I wanted to check it on the harness. I had to look up on the line to figure out where I can test 5 volts. And from what I saw, if we can show you guys, on this top harness here, do you see all those red wires on the back side? They're on the soldering side. Each of those red wires is 5 volts. So not the part side, which is this side here. It's actually each side of the connector is different. And on this one, the soldering side, those 5 red cables are 5 volts. And I did see that it was getting... Let's stay there. It was getting 5.3 at the power supply. And I'm going to test it right here as well. Just touch on one of the red guys and see. Wow, 5.001. Well, I mean, that's as good as it gets. Let's take this off. So, I mean, maybe I just got to shake something. I don't know, but it's getting perfect voltage. I mean, you can't get any more perfect than that. I mean, before I haven't tried, I mean, it's still on, I haven't checked it since, but it's probably still the, oh, okay, I literally just powered it on earlier, and I was still getting the white screen when I set up a little makeshift setup there, and then I went here and started testing voltages, unplugging connectors, and putting it back. I literally just unplugged basically these two, just kind of pressed on these a bit. Didn't do much more than that and check voltages. And now we have mouse trap. It's actually working. Yay. Well, that's kind of cool. Actually, the monitor looks pretty good. Wow, so I don't really know what I did. I cleaned up the cabinet and I unplugged and put in back some of the connectors. And I checked voltages. That's basically what I did. And now it's working. All right. Well, I mean, that's cool. That's something. Cool. Sweet. Oh, this whole game will be cool once it's all set up. All right, great. Well, I'm glad I actually hooked up the monitor then. I literally just turned it on earlier before I checked the cables. And it was still coming up all white. So I wonder what that means. Back here and look. I wonder if one of these... Is there a bad solder connection on one of them? I don't know. I mean, it was these two of the main guys I played with, and these two.
I wonder if I just gotta eventually take them off and clean them. Maybe it's something simple like that. I wonder if there's any way to test if there's sounds. Where's the... I don't know how the heck you insert a coin here or do a free... I don't remember where it is on these guys. It's always different. Is there like a service switch or something like that? It's making weird sound in there. Oh, actually, the weird sound could be from the speaker because the sound is just bad.
Well, anyway, okay, that's kind of a pleasant surprise. I took a little break from my cleaning to play with this and actually got it back up and running. Well, this shows the guy was truthful. I mean, the game was working. I guess something got jostled during moving, so that's pretty cool. All right. Okay, good. So, in that case, now I can get back to cleaning because I really want to clean this thing inside out. Once it's clean inside out, I can get the monitor back in there, and then I can start trying to figure out the sound issue. Because at least the good thing is once it's all cleaned, I can put it all back because all servicing should be possible from right here, which is kind of nice. So, all right, this time I will get back to cleaning. Kind of happy that the game is actually working now, but let me get back to it. Yeah, I know. I said I was supposed to keep cleaning, but I was curious to see if I could find a quick sound fix. So I decided to probe a little more. There's two boards in this stack for the mouse trap. And these little clips, you can just kind of pinch them and pop them off, and you can get the top board off. The only thing connected to the top board is basically this harness here, and there's a couple over here. So I took the top board off just to see maybe if there's a cold solder joint or something like that. So I have the board here, and this is the kind of stuff I was looking for, all little solder joints here and here, and where this ribbon cable goes here and all along there. Looking for anything that could be wrong, either like bad traces, broken solder connections, but unfortunately everything looks fine. I'm not seeing anything that's jumping out at me from a quick look, but I figured I'd just fill you in on what I'm doing. I think I may clean the connections that these ones plug into. I'll try doing that. I mean, it could be just these ribbon cables have gone bad, I don't know. But anyway, I'm still kind of exploring this. Yeah, I know, I'm going to get back to cleaning eventually, but I figured I'd give this a shot. Maybe it'd be a quick, easy fix. So I'm going to try cleaning some stuff and then putting this board back and see what happens. So I did have a little bit of a step back. I've still been mucking around with the audio here, trying to kind of figure out what's going on. And I did the usual. You know, I checked voltages at the harness over there. It's a perfect 5. I unplugged all the connectors and stuff, and I used some contact cleaner. This is the kind of contact cleaner I was using on the pots. So I did look up in the manual briefly, and I saw there's 4 pots here. 1, 2, 3, and 4. And it's interesting how the audio works on this. Normally there's 1 pot for all audio, but this one has 4. This is like kind of the master audio. This one is for effects, that one is for music, and that one is for the dog, strangely enough. So anyway, just in case, I kind of cleaned out all the, hit the pots with contact cleaner and used the screwdriver on them, turned them, you know, did them full rotation in case they were gummed up. Nothing changed the audio. The audio still doesn't work. The setback is when I was taking out this particular one, I broke pin 8. Yep, kind of a meatball thing to do, but there it is. I broke pin 8, and as a result, the game is now doing this. Kind of annoying. So, you know, I think, I mean, I tried the usual stuff, the voltages, the connectors, or the contact cleaner. You know, I've done all that. I think it's time I gotta look at a schematic. I've never done the schematic thing before, but I think it's time to go figure out. I'm going to go upstairs to the office and start doing a little bit of a little more research on the audio of Mousetrap. All right, I'm back in the office. I've been doing some research here, and I got the camera all set up, showing my screen here so I can show you guys what the heck I've been doing. So, disclaimer here, you know, this is brand new turf to me. This is nothing I've ever done before, diagnosing board problems. So I'm just going to, you know, think things aloud. I know for people who have experience doing this, you'll probably get annoyed at some of the things I say, and think some of the things will be probably totally wrong. But, you know, I'm going to just vocalize my process and see if I can figure this out. And I'll figure it out on camera and just see what the heck happens. So this is the process I've been going through. I'm kind of devouring data here, trying to understand how this all works. I've never used a logic probe, and I've never had to deal with schematics, but now is the time. So, first things first, I found here in the middle, you can see the mouse right there, the Mousetrap manual. Third edition is kind of the one you want. There's a first edition out there, but the third edition includes the schematic, which is kind of important. So that is the one I you know, you want to look at. Here, incidentally, make this a little wider. So right here you can see On the mouse trap, it's a two board stack. Actually, I'll show you what I got open here. I got the mouse trap manual in the middle. I got a picture of my board set over here, and I got a YouTube video here, and I'll tell you what this is for in a moment. But you look, going back to the board stack, you can see there's kind of one down below here that's behind it, and then one in the front. This front one I've determined is the audio board, and of course, sure enough, it also says mouse trap audio right over there. But that one on top is the audio board, and you can see it here on top as well. And you can see here are the pots. This is where I first saw dog volume, music volume, master volume, and special effects volume. So that's what clued me into that, just in case you're wondering. But we'll keep on going here. Parts list, I'm not concerned with right now. And here, this is the schematic area. This is where we need to be looking at. So it starts about here. I'm going to just rotate this. Make this a little bigger. Okay, now here's how I'm trying to figure out what is for what. Now on the, down here it says 6502 game logic PCB. I know there's two boards, one's the logic board, one's the audio board, so all the ones that say game logic I'm not really interested in right now. See, this one is game logic, this one's game logic, game logic. It keeps going as game logic board for a little while here. Okay, and there we go. Right here it starts, this guy here, and it says down here, mousetrap audio and color, and it says sheet 1 of 5. So there are 5 sheets specific for the audio board, which is kind of the one I'm interested in. So here's 1, here's 2, here's 3, it's 4, and this is 5. So these are the ones I've been looking at. These 5 schematics are documenting the audio board and kind of what I need to sort out to figure out this problem. So I figured out... one thing I figured out right away, well not right away, but relatively quickly, this last sheet here, sheet 5, it seems like the mousetrap audio board does more than just audio. It seems like it handles color and sync and other things. You can look at this one here, it says for the audio board, but look at all the stuff here, red latch data, red data latch, green data latch, blue data latch, color selection, you know, red, green, blue out, sync, there's all this color related stuff. So I don't think this sheet is going to concern me too much. But one thing I did find that was interesting right up here, I'm hoping all this comes out reasonably clean, but I'll zoom in here, maybe that'll help for this one. Right up here, it talks about connector J20. That's the one I broke pin 8 on. And if you look at the pin numbers in 1 through 14 here, pin 8 says it's V-Sync. And sure enough, I'm getting a vertical roll on my mousetrap. So that's the problem. I did find a new little connector. Fortunately, those only cost about $3. I think it's the right size. So I ordered that. Hopefully that's a simple swap and it won't be a major pain. But at least that's one thing I was able to kind of, you know, confirm, which is kind of cool. I did break the V-Sync pin on J20. But anyway, going back to this, sheet 5 doesn't really concern me. So I was looking at sheet 1, 2, to 4. This is my plan of attack. There's so many parts and stuff. I don't want to... I figure there's kind of 2 ways this thing goes wrong. One, there's a problem in one of these myriad of audio parts here somewhere that is causing the audio to fail along the way. Or two, the whole audio circuit works and the problem is delivery of the audio. So maybe there's a problem on a connector or on a harness or something like that. So my theory was, let me try to identify something I can test very far into the circuit, almost all the way to the end, basically, to help me confirm, is this thing actually making audio? Because I figure if I can confirm that near the end of the circuit, stuff is going on and it's making audio, then I won't need to test anything before that. I'll know the problem is after that. So I went through all these sheets, and sheet 5, I did say it was color stuff, so I was kind of ignoring this one. And instead I went here to sheet 4, and I noticed right here on the corner, it just says two speaker. That sounds pretty final to me, or end of the line, end of the circuit to me. So I started going backwards, and I can see here there's some transistors and stuff. I don't know what all these symbols mean yet, but this is something I got to learn over time. There's the master volume pot as indicated. There's the effects volume. But going back, it kind of goes to here. I notice these 3 big boys right here, and they're all labeled 4051. And there's 3 of them. And, you know, my immediate thought was, I mean, this could be, again, wrong. But the way this board handles audio is like a separate volume knob for the 3 main things. There's a master volume knob, but there's also one for sound effects, for the dog, and for music. 3 things. So I almost wonder if each of these is responsible. Maybe this one does the dog, this one does music, this one does sound effects or something like that. I don't know, but Regardless, it seemed like a good point to test. It's almost at the end of the circuit because the speaker is here, and they look large enough that they must be relatively well-known chips. And there's two identifying marks. There's a 4051 over here, and then there's D10, D11, D12. The D10, D11, D12 numbers let you locate them on the board. So this is a picture of my board. And on the side, hopefully it's not cutting it off there. On the side, there's these letters, you see, A, B, C, D. So row D is this row right here. And then, of course, there's numbers going across. So when this thing says D10, D11, and D12, we go down to row D, and there we go, D10, D11, D12. So it is identifying these three chips right here. So those are the three chips I'm going to test. They seem to be of importance. I don't know. But to test them, I need to figure out what in the heck they are. So I Googled just IC4051, and then a whole bunch of stuff comes up. And I guess they are a typical IC that anybody can buy. They're called a multiplexer, which, I'll be honest, doesn't tell me a whole lot. because I'm new to this. I need to figure out more. So I went to YouTube, and that's what this video here is for. I'm going to just slide this over. So I found this guy's video. This guy's name is David Watts, and this video is called 4000 Series Logic ICs, the 4051 8-Channel Analog Multiplexer Demultiplexer IC. So he talks about this particular chip that I'm interested in, the 4051, and you can watch his video to get more information on it. And you can see up here, in fact, let's get it maybe a little bit closer. And he's got a pinout and everything. The pinout you can find elsewhere as well. But so long story short, my understanding from watching this video is this: the way this pin works is you got, see there's these three lines here, pins 9, 10, 11, and then there's eight other pins all labeled with Y, Y0 to Y7. Some are here and some are there. What you can do with this chip is send in a 3-bit pattern on these select lines here on pins 9, 10, 11, and that'll control which one of these it comes out of, whether it's on Y0, Y1, Y2, and you can go both ways. What I think, if that is the case, let's get this back in here. So I'm thinking then, those three pins on the 4051, pins 9, 10, 11, if audio is being funneled through these chips, there should be activity on pins 9, 10, and 11. There should be things going on if the audio circuit is working. If something was broken ahead of it, then I'm guessing there would be nothing at all. But in our case, like we're hearing, it's not like we're hearing broken audio on Mousetrap. It is completely dead audio. So I'm thinking if these things are showing activity, it means everything before it is actually working fine, and everything after it is what needs to be investigated as a problem. So I have a logic probe, and I've never used it, but I'm going to use it. I'm going to figure out how to use a logic probe to check these three pins. Now, his pinout, let's go back to here, back to my board picture. So we determined these three are the 4051 chips. I'm going to check each one. And to determine where pin 9, 10, 11 is, you can see the notch at the top, and pin 1 is over there. On mine, pin 1 is at the bottom right. So if you guys can see this, so it goes pin 1 to 7 on this side. Pin 1 to 8 on this side. And then at the other side, the top left is pin, starting from the top left is pin 9, 10, and 11 going downwards. So this is my plan, and this is my thinking. The thought is those three pins on each of those three chips, if I get audio, I need to make the game do some audio. And if I do, those three pins should be showing activity. If they are showing activity with the logic probe, to me that means everything prior to this thing on the circuit, so everything going back on sheet 3, 2, 1, all that stuff, is working fine. In other words, everything is working. I can verify that everything is working until this point in the circuit. That is my theory. So, okay, I gotta go bust out the logic probe. How do I make the game make sound? I don't have the putting a quarter in. Hold on, I have MAME. I need to be able to make the game, have the game make sound, so that I can put the logic probe on one of those pins and make the game do some sound. So usually putting a quarter in, of course, makes sound. I must have, Mousetrap, I have it on my favorites here. You hear those songs, mine doesn't make any of those sounds at all booting up. I wonder if those sounds, it was plays three sounds. Each sound was to test one of those 4051s, I wonder. Or just to test each of the music channels. So normally when you put in a quarter in a game, they always make some kind of obnoxious sound, which is exactly what I want. Because I can just, every time I put in a quarter, it'll make a sound and I can test the IC. I forgot these Exidy games take a while to boot up. Mine's version 4, by the way. Alright, so, cool. That's a long sound. Every time I put in a quarter, it does a few seconds of audio. Actually, it goes for quite a while, 3 or 4 seconds of audio. Perfect. Alright, let me close this and get rid of MAME. So, this is what I'm going to do. Every time I put in a quarter, I know it'll make the sound. So that's the plan. I'm going to test out these pins. Let's go back to my board. On these three guys right here, these three chips, I'm going to test all three of the pins at the top left. Basically, I'll put the probe on a pin there, insert a quarter, see if anything happens. Put a probe in the next pin, insert a quarter. Probe in the next pin, insert a quarter. That chip tested. Go to the next one, go to the next one. So if we're lucky, it'll show activity, because at least that'll, I'm hoping that'll narrow down. I don't want to mess with the whole circuit too much. There's all kinds of stuff going on. So that is what I'm going to do right now. And I guess I got to go figure out how to use the Logic Probe. I got it downstairs. It's time to bust out the manual and see how that thing works. Hopefully you guys follow this. I just wanted to, all my thoughts, I'm pretty much just saying them, because I've never done this. And I'm not really sure what to do. So I figured, let me just vocalize it as I go. Capture it on video, and I don't know, we'll see if this is dumb or if this is smart. I have no idea, but this is how I'm going to proceed. So let me just go back downstairs and get that Logic Probe out. All right, guys, I got this all set up. I got my Logic Probe set up. I looked in the manual how to hook it up. Here's the Logic Probe, and it's got two cables coming off. But a black cable I had sent in here to a ground, and the red cable is connected to the +5 volt on the switching power supply at the bottom. And I have to insert a quarter over here. I took the little two things off of the quarter mech, and when I touch here, every time you hear that thunk, means it's inserting a quarter, and then it should play that little mouse trap, that sound we heard upstairs, that goes for about 4 seconds, like whatever the heck it was. Now what we should see here, see when I touch the probe, normally you should just see just low. So I know different chips, in certain cases supposed to be high, certain cases supposed to be low. What I'm looking for is to see the high and low changing and the sound changing. That'll tell me that audio is kind of flowing to these chips and making it there. So that's what I'm going to try right now. Let's try that. Let's put a quarter in. Yeah, there's definitely activity. Actually, I was on pin one. Maybe just go to pin one on the next one. There's activity there too. Let's try the third chip. Yeah, there's definitely activity. Let's try the second pin. So these are the D10, D11, D12 chips we were talking about. Let's try pin two over here. Oh, that is definite activity. Interesting. So, I mean, heck, let's time it. It was about 4 seconds of music it would play every time you put a quarter in, right? So, let's try it. 1, 2, 3, 4. Yeah. Doesn't that seem to imply the data is flowing to these chips? Don't you think? Maybe this wasn't a crazy experiment after all. What about pin 3 over here? Yeah. Okay. I mean, if I understand this right, you know, we're putting in the quarter by tripping this, plays a little 4 second blurb, and these guys are making those three pins, those three select pins, I think it was pins 9, 10, 11 at the top left of each chip. There was input, there was data coming to it. So that tells me that the whole audio circuit, I mean, if it were broken, it would be garbled sound, and if it were garbled sound, you'd still be seeing activity here, it would just be incorrect. In our case, because there's no sound at all, I figured if there was a problem prior,
inserting a quarter would make no difference on those three pins at all. You would hear nothing. But we're seeing activity. It's sending sounds. They're making it all the way to these multiplexers. And then somewhere after that is where the problem is. That's what I'm going to go with. I think that makes sense. I hope that makes sense. Logic probes are pretty cool. Assuming I'm on the right track anyway. I think this is the right idea. All right, so what I'm going to do... Well, I mean, the good news is this gives us a clue. The bad news is it doesn't solve the problem, but at least it helps me from not having to worry about all the other stuff here. So it's just these three and later. Maybe it goes up this way towards the harness. I'm not sure. I remember seeing these two guys here, Q1, Q2, right before the speaker area. So I suspect it's going through this. And there's the master volume too, which was afterwards. Yeah, so it's probably going through this section, maybe into the harness and then back out to where it needs to go. Okay. All right. Well, that was kind of cool. Gives me a little bit of a clue as to what's going on. Now I got to figure out, back to the schematic, I guess, pretty much, and start looking after those three chips there and try to figure out what else there is that we can test. So I'm still toying around with the Logic Probe. Check this out. I kind of went along on the schematic. You know, I checked those 4051 chips, and I wanted to see, okay, those seem to be working. So let me keep on going and see what other chips there are, and maybe check those too. And these three here, which are the 4051s, seem to flow into the schematic, or at least according to the schematic, over here to a 4053, which is another multiplexer. So I figured, let me just test that out, but I have the game on, but check this out. It almost sounds like I'll do this one of the output pins here. Check this out. I mean, it almost sounds like the audio for when you put a quarter in. It's like you can almost hear it. Oops, my little thing came out here. Let me put this back. This is my little makeshift trigger. Try that pin up here. Can you hear that? I mean, it does sound like this a little bit like a part of the sound when you put a quarter in. You hear that? So to me it looks like this guy's working too. Plus additionally, I looked up a little more detail on these multiplexers. They all seem to have one common thing. There's an inhibitor or an enable pin that should read low. If it reads high, then output is being prevented, which could be a sign of a bad chip. So it's supposed to read low on all the multiplexers. And it's the third pin from the top on the right side. So I can check all these. I'm gonna have to probably get in your way with this one, but I don't know if there's any way to do it and for you guys to see it, but for me to also be able to... Does that let you see it? I don't know, we can try that. So I'm checking the third pin from the top. They should all be low, otherwise output is inhibited. So that's low. That is low. That is low. And up to this multiplexer right here, low. That's one of those cases where the low high is very useful. It tells you info about this chip. So low on the enable or inhibitor pin, which is the third pin from the top on the right side, means that it is allowing output. So these are cool. And checking the switches on this multiplexer, the 4053, I'm hearing mousetrap sounds. So make sure that's recording okay. Yeah. So this seems like that one is working. So I'm going to keep on going. From what I can tell, right up until here, which is very far into the end of the schematic, it looks like it's working. One little thing I am wondering about, I mentioned these two transistors and they have to be heat sinked, implying that they get hot. But I've had the game on now and I'm feeling them. These things are ice cold. I mean, there's not an ounce of heat on here. I just gotta be wondering about these two guys. These are Q1 and Q2. I mean, you put a heat sink on it, you think these would get warm. Now, I've seen these on other games, and they do tend to run warm, and sometimes very hot. I remember they burned up on my paperboy, and they had to be changed. Yeah, I don't feel any heat at all, which is kind of interesting. So these are three pins in the back, yeah. Kind of wondering about these guys. I'm a little bit suspicious. But anyway, it's getting near the end of the trail here. At this point, it gets into the harness, and one of these wires, I forget which one is the speaker wire, so it seemed like the problem, you would think, is somewhere in here. I'm looking at these remaining capacitors, you know, nothing seems like it's leaking, you know, bulging or exploded. The volume knobs, you can rotate them, and since I don't know if all the way left is on or all the way right is on, you know, put them in the middle, so I'll get some sound. You know, you kind of rotate them a bit and I put them in the middle. Do that with all of them here. I assume full counterclockwise is on, but you know what? Who knows? So I'll put them in the middle. Just double check. Yeah, no audio still. All right, so I'm going to keep looking in the schematic here and see what else is next, but yeah, I got to say, these are interesting. Why? I mean, if they run this cold, they wouldn't need heatsink. And it wouldn't specify it in the schematic either. I guess the other clue, maybe if it is these, is, you know, stuff that needs a heatsink tends to run hot and is more likely to burn out because heat's the enemy of these things. But so anyway, on the schematic, we've kind of skipped everything, kind of came around here, and we're up to here right now. And it's just these guys in here. So I'm going to keep probing around and see what I can find. And the audio testing continues. I think I may have found the culprit. It was definitely not what I was expecting. So I followed through the schematic, which, you know, we went through these three chips here. I found out they lead through this, and then they go to this one here, which is another multiplexer that I tested. And it gives sounds just fine. I tested it the same way by putting the little probe on the outputs, and I was getting sounds. And this is a TI-084. And then these go, according to the schematic, to this guy here, which is an LM7741. I tested that, and I was getting sounds on that one, too. And I'm like, okay, that then leads to these transistors, which weren't very cool, but whatever. And I check on the schematic here, let's see, I have my little cheat sheet down here. So pin 7 is the speaker. So 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. So I just go ahead and get it right on the speaker. And here's my little wire. I need a way to, well, we can even do it on boot up, actually. If you listen closely on boot up, this game makes various noises. There's one, and here's another one pretty soon. See, there's another one. And then it'll do a little glook after about 10 seconds or so, 15 seconds. After it's self-test, it makes that other little sound. Hear that? So, right over here, that's a very familiar, that's the mousetrap boot sound. Everything works right here, and this feeds up to this wire here, which is wire 7. I even tested it over there with the probe, and I heard it there. So then I started following the wire. I'm like, okay, this whole board is generating sound and sending audio over this wire. There's nothing wrong with the board, as far as I can tell. So I'm like, let me start following this wire. And for here, I'm going to have to get some stuff out of the way. I'm going to get my laptop out of the way so I don't bash it. And get the probe out of the way. And I'm going to have to handhold, because this is where it gets interesting. So I'm like, okay, that's that brown wire, right? Follow it, and it takes me to that connection right there. I do the same thing. I put the probe on there, turn it on, you hear that same bloom, 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 bloom sound. Sound is making it to there, so I follow that. That goes to the harness, it goes all the way up here, goes right to the speaker. I'm like, okay. Hold on a second, let me touch this on the speaker and the probe, turn it on. Sure enough, you're hearing sounds right here. I'm like, how is this possible? Sound is making it all the way here. And then I took a look inside. I don't know if this is going to be possible to see. How am I going to light this? Can you guys see that in there? A certain wire has been chewed through. Basically, the wire here, there's the connector, but the wire inside the speaker is chewed, it's gone, it's broken. That's why there's no audio. I don't know if you guys can see it or not, but the wire is broken. Our friend the mouse strikes again. Not only was he chewing the cardboard over there, but he chewed through the wire. So you can see a little bit of the wire over here, but inside it's completely disconnected. It's just shredded. I just think that's hilarious that that was the actual problem. There you can see a little stub. There we go. It just chewed through. So, I mean, the irony of the situation doesn't escape me, that the problem with no audio on Mousetrap is very possibly due to a mouse. You can't make this stuff up. So, even I've been fumbling around with this thing and all my plan of attack and all this stuff, and I think the board is completely fine.
The problem is the speaker wire is broken. So I want to hunt around for a spare speaker and see if I can quickly plug that in and see if we get any sounds. All right, guys, I found an old pinball speaker, actually. I just kind of hastily threw it up there. It's a little bit precarious, but I was just curious to see what the hell happened. So let us stand back. This has to be it. I mean, the damn mouse chewed the wire. What else could it be? So let's put this over here, kill this light. And let me go power this guy on. Hopefully we hear a mouse trap. Little bump buzz there, it's kind of weird. Oh, that sounded good. Okay, it's gotta go through the testing. That sounds like mousetrap to me, yes. I cannot believe we had no sound because of a mouse in mousetrap. Now the screen roller, because I screwed up that cable, of course, trying to debug this. I did order a new one, so hopefully it'll fix that. Let me try inserting a coin. You should be hearing the coin sound now. That's it. Control panel on there, actually. Let me see if I get the control panel to start a game. Oh, so we can try a little bit more, like the music, just to see if music and other things work. Just quickly put this here. I'm not really going to connect it, but just enough so I can press that one player start button. There we go. That is Mousetrap, all right. Cool. Looks like the cat sound works, music sound works. Cool. All right. Well, that's that. Oh man, that's a relief. Okay. So, sound is sorted. I need another speaker. It looks like the speaker in there is a typical 16x9. I don't have one like that. I guess I can go buy one or something. I'll look around. I'll find whatever I can find. It's any 8-ohm speaker, I guess, to that similar bolt pattern should work. I'm curious if I could put two speakers in there because it has two speaker panels in there. I don't know. I'll look that up. But anyway, there we go. Audio on Mousetrap is fixed. All of that probe work and all that other studying the schematics, nah, no need. Mouse to chew the cable. All right. So if that's the case, now I'm going to officially get back to cleaning this thing. I know the audio, I can take care of it later. So time to get cleaning so I can put the monitor back in. All right, I took out the speaker. I'm getting a closer up view here so you guys can see. I kind of lifted the cable out. As you can see, it was just chewed away. Brown cable was here on the negative lead. This is supposed to go to the speaker. And the mouse had other ideas. That was the entire problem. Here it is. It's just making me laugh. This is kind of a Sling Blade moment. I don't know if any of you have seen the movie Sling Blade. They're trying to figure out where the lawnmower is working and all trying to look at the motor and the spark plugs and all this kind of stuff. And the dude walks up to it just like, it ain't got no gas in it. You know, it's like kind of one of those moments. I did all that work on the board, looking around and the speaker doesn't work because the speaker cable is cut. That's all there was to it. I figured I'd show that. So it is another 8-ohm speaker. All this stuff has, I mean, you can see even at the top area, there's some rodent poop. And there's this kind of staining, which I think the rodent kind of took a leak on it or something. So there's going to be a lot of cleanup to do in this thing. That's for sure. So, but it's a typical 8-ohm speaker. I'll find another matching pattern somewhere just so it'll make it easier to mount and go buy another one. Been busy getting everything out of the way here. Got stuff on the table down here. Because I'm going to focus on cleanup now. So what I'm going to try, I'm trying to do this as just a basic cleanup, you know, keep it like a survivor because everything's pretty much original on this guy. So I'm just going to start with cleaning. I'm going to clean the inside. Just with like damp cloth and stuff like that. Go over a little bit of everything, mildly damp cloth, just because of the rodents that lived in there. So top to bottom, I want to give it a cleanup. And on the outside, I'm going to go with something different. People on YouTube and Klopp are constantly raving about this magic eraser, so this is what I'm going to try. Use that to clean the sides, the front, basically all the outside, hit with magic eraser and see what I can clean up. and a light damp cloth on the inside, and we'll see if I can bring this thing shine back. It isn't too bad, but it's definitely, you know, dirty and dingy here and there. So I'm gonna get busy on that right now, giving it all a nice spit and polish, as they say. Hopefully it'll come out nice and clean. I'll just show you guys a difference of before and after. See, I'm cleaning over here, how white it looks as the before. Yeah, because there was a mouse living in here, so this is gross. So that is how the whole machine's gonna look inside. It's gonna take some time, but whatever. I gotta get it clean. I can't deal with that. So it's all gonna become that in short order, the entire inside. So just wanted to show you the difference. Now I'm gonna get back to it. Just a quick peek, I finished the inside. So you can see now, somewhat more white. Took off both speaker covers just to be sure. And even on the inside, I've hit every surface with a cloth. It takes some time, but at least now it's somewhat cleaner. Some stains are perma stains, unfortunately, here. I couldn't get them out even with like CLR or that kind of thing. You know, or even on the top of this thing here, it's just permanently stained. There's some stuff I can't do anything about. But, well, the poop is gone and mouse food and all that other various things. So the inside is all clean. Now I'm gonna slide the board back in and start to work on the outside. But probably first work on the side art with that magic eraser. I'm curious to see how well that'll work. Yeah, the cleanup is done. I mean, you know, I won't lie, it is very tempting to like throw some white paint on there and black paint in the front and all that, but I'm trying to do this one as a survivor and just to leave it be, leave it all original. So I'm gonna stick to that. It's pretty good. I mean, it's not as, you know, clean as it would look fully restored, of course, but it's not bad. Now I'm kind of working up top here. I don't know if you guys can see, I ended up repairing the speaker. I ended up just soldering a cable between that negative lead and the speaker itself, and it seems to work. And it was missing the bulb up there, so I just bought a bulb from Home Depot, put it in, and it works. So it looks like the starter is somewhere there. Usually those tend to go bad, but in this case, it's pretty good. So I actually just finished cleaning now the marquee as well. You know, it's interesting. It had some sticky stuff on it all over there. Normally, I use Goo Gone. It tends to be my preferred method, better than the Goof Off. But this time, Goo Gone just couldn't remove it. So I tried Goof Off, and that one did remove it. Go figure. I don't know, I guess it's useful to have both. I'm going to get that guy on there and see what that looks like. All right, assembled the whole marquee area. So it's not too bad. You can take a look at it from the side now and see a cleaned up version. In the front here. Yeah, like your hit marquee has some scuffs, but that's okay. My goal in this one, I'm trying to not use not one new part or one drop of paint. I just want to get this guy cleaned up, serviced, and ready to go. There are a few things that are missing. I had no choice. I ended up putting my little twist locks on there because the old ones we didn't have the key for. I didn't have a choice there. I did have to put a little coin button because this doesn't have a free play or a service switch or anything like that, and that works. You can see. Now, in spite of saying no paint or anything like that, I am tempted to actually, you know, touch up there. Some of that paint is bubbling. This thing clearly had some water damage, and you can see it here and there. And in the front, you can see the paint, some of it bubbled, even a little bit more over there is going to bubble and come right off. So I may end up touching up these coin doors, I don't know. Just because that rusted area really stands out. The rest of it is not too bad, though. It's looking pretty good. Yes, the screen's rolling. I still haven't gotten the replacement ribbon cable yet. But that'll come eventually. Actually, it should come within a week, actually. But it's not looking too bad. I kind of like it. It's different. I mean, I'm so used to tearing stuff apart, stripping it down, painting everything, you know, to make it look all new. This whole survivor thing is definitely a new thing. Something I wanted to try, and Mousetrap seemed like a good candidate since this was all original. You know, so I figured why not give it a go with this one. So I've got next, the bezel's just kind of sitting down there on the table. It's just a matter of washing and putting it in, not a big deal. The control panel's the biggie, and that one is pretty darn dirty. I have that on the floor over here. So I'm going to pretty much take that all apart. I'm going to reuse the control panel. Same thing, I'm not buying any new parts. Everything there is going to be reused. Just take it apart and cleaned. I'll use some of the magic eraser on it as well. It's, you know, it does a decent job, but I read some guy used Armor All on one of these things to make it look pretty good. So it's something I'm contemplating as well. But that's the next step. I've got to get that guy up on the table here, strip it all down, and get all the parts all cleaned up. So start taking apart the control panel here. It's interesting. It's a little different than some of the other ones. I'll zoom in. I've been kind of labeling what's what. But I guess the easiest way to see this would be on this guy right here. It doesn't have just the usual two controls. It has two additional ones because each of the buttons is lit. The three colored buttons to control the gates in the maze each have a light behind them, as does the dog button, as do the one and two player buttons. That's why there's four on each. And I've been leaving them. It took me a second to figure out how to take them off, but you just got to twist this thing and pull it out. It took me a second. You don't have to take apart the whole assembly. You literally just do that. And you can see there's a bulb on it. All right, I've taken out the control panel. There's the, or taken it apart, I should say. There's all the wiring harness in pieces, and I just put it there on the side. The control panel itself is right here. And like I said, I'm not going to put a new control panel overlay or anything like that. I'm going to reuse this, clean it thoroughly inside and out. Zoom in a bit more here. And yeah, it's dirty and all that, but whatever. I can clean it. You can see the inside here. It's kind of a mess. But this will be totally clean. And I will try Armor All. Like some of the guys at Mouse Trap that he restored, he did kind of a survivor thing too. It didn't change very much, but he used Armor All on the control panel to make it shine. So I'm going to try that too. Add a little bit of elbow grease. There we go. I think it cleaned up pretty nice. I'm not going to bother with the Armor All step. I'm just going to leave it like this. It looks pretty clean. I like it. All right. Time to begin the reassembly of all this stuff. Well, actually, I can't reassemble just yet. I got to clean up all the individual buttons now. I got those sitting on the table down here. All those guys, I got to get those all cleaned up now, and then I can reassemble. So just a quick FYI as to how the buttons come apart to be these three components, which is the spring, the underneath, and the little frame. Here's a blue button I haven't taken apart. You just got to squeeze the two tabs here and push the button right on through, like so. And then you can see the spring sits on the inside. You can take that out. There's the frame and there's the button. So I'm taking them all apart like this, kind of rinsing them, cleaning them up, because they get soda and other gunk inside them over time. So give them all a nice little wash and then reassemble everything. All the controls are there. Well, the joystick I'm not going to put in yet. I painted, and I wasn't going to use a drop of paint, and that was the plan, but I'm almost following that. Just the screw tops, they were really rusted. And the screws, they show here, you know, on top of the control panel. I want them to look black. That's it. I just hit them with some black paint. The other thing that I may end up painting is the coin doors. The more I work with them and play around with them, close this up. As you can see here, a lot of this paint was bubbled and it's just flaking off because it did have some water damage and there's some rust here. I think I'm going to have no choice but to paint that. I mean, that just looks bad. So I'm not going to paint the cabinet area. I'm probably just going to take just the doors off and just paint those just to hide the rust, because obviously there's a huge rust patch there, but there's also some over there. And okay. You know, sometimes you have to do some painting, I guess. So that's what I'll do. But anyway, once these screws here dry up, those guys right there, I can put the joystick back in, connect the control panel, and hopefully all the buttons will light up. Most of everything are reassembled. So I did plan on putting LED bulbs back in here. I measured the voltages. I mean, well, I didn't have to even measure it, really. All the bulbs inside the controls were labeled 12 volt. But the problem was the spacing is really tight, and my 12 volt bulbs are kind of large, but they're long, my LED bulbs, I should say, and they wouldn't make it all the way through. They would actually hit this part from the back, so they couldn't fit. So I'm keeping the incandescence for now. If I find some very small or lower profile 12 volt LED bulbs, and I'll change them out, because it's pretty simple. You can just flip the control panel open and change them out. But the incandescence, I believe, do work. Let me turn off the, so you can see it. So they do work. It's lighting up the dog button and all the little gate buttons. The 1 and 2 player buttons don't light up until you insert quarters, which is kind of cool. So like if I insert one quarter, you see the 1 player button lights up. If I insert 2 quarters, it does that to show you how you can play 2 players. I'll just start a 2-player game, let it go. Now there is one thing I wanted to ask about, I guess. Well, that Mouse Trap play. I made one little change. For those who have a Mouse Trap, you can always correct me, I guess, in the comments, but... Well, here, I'll hold it up. Well, no, I'm going to go ahead and just open it up and shut this guy off. There we go. It turns off because of the little switch. There's a little switch down in the coin door area that, you know, when it opens up, it pretty much shuts the But I gotta open the control panel to show you something I did a slight mod, I guess you could say. Let's do that like that, you like that, you like that, and you like that. And to show you what I got in mind is I have to take out the bezel. Now, on my Mouse Trap, see this bezel that's in here? It didn't come with anything at all. It was just completely open. So when you put the other bezel on top, well, this is the monitor shroud, I should say. There was no monitor shroud included on mine at all. So all this is wide open. So when you had the bezel on top, you can literally, let's see if I can raise this guy. A little bit of a better view. You can literally just see right through. You can see wiring. You can see the back of the cabinet. That looked kind of strange to me. Is that how Mousetrap is supposed to be? Honestly, I don't know. I mean, I've never owned one, but it just looks weird because you're looking, when you're looking through that bezel, especially at the top, you're seeing into the back of the cabinet. It didn't look that good. So I had a spare bezel lying around, or spare monitor shroud, I should say. I just cut at the bottom, and it's just sitting inside here, right on top of the wooden shelf. I cut enough from the bottom so they could sit and just be, you know, reasonably well aligned. I might have to cut a little more, to be honest. Yeah, because I could see a little bit of Mont Blanc there. I probably need to cut just a little bit more. But for now, this is okay. So I, you know, mine didn't come with me. I added that. It just looks better to me, because when you're playing, then you're not seeing the innards of the game. Slide this down there. And I'll get the control panel back on just in a moment. There's one. So here now you can see, I mean, you still see up top, I guess, you know, it doesn't cover everything. But it's better than it was. I mean, before you were seeing wires and everything, it just looked really odd to me. Like they would be designed that way, but I suppose it was. I don't know. In any case, most everything is together here and clean and working. I did test the controls. I'm still waiting on that new ribbon cable, which will fix this screen roll because, oh my God, I was trying to test out the controls. Playing it like this, and I was, oh my God, I was getting a headache. But so I have that ribbon cable I gotta change. Everything else is clean, and I'm gonna just touch up these coin doors here, get some paint on them because of all the rust. I'm gonna remove whatever other paint is bubbling, just hit the coin doors with some black paint, and that should wrap this guy up. It's not looking too bad, I think. My Survivor project, never done a Survivor project before, but I've kept it all original, I haven't changed any part on this. So far, the only paint I've put on it is these four screws, because these are rusted and it just would have looked so ugly. I painted these four screws, but other than that, everything is just, you know, cleaned, demoused, and I got the audio working. So anyway, it's almost there. I'm gonna get going on I guess the door, paint those doors, and then in a few days hopefully I'll get that ribbon cable and I'll go ahead and install that. Hey guys, it's bright and early in the morning. Okay, not really early for me. It's 10:48 a.m. and I just got the ribbon cable for a Mousetrap, which I'm going to go install and hopefully fix that screen rolling for once and for all. So just to show you which one I got it up on the web page here. Let's see. There we go. So I got it from DigiKey, DigiKey.com. And I guess the important part is the part number. Well, the info is right there. So that's the one I bought. I ended up buying two. I always buy a spare. You know, you're paying for shipping anyway, so I may as well get two in case I break another pin. So this is only $3, by the way. So I'm going to go get this installed right now and hopefully can actually play Mousetrap. Just finished replacing that cable that I got from DigiKey, and we have Mousetrap once again. No more screen roll. Well, I'm glad that's sorted, at least for my little screw-up. So one more thing down. I think all that remains now is dealing with this rusted coin door. Get that painted. And I think this guy will be a wrap. And Mousetrap is all complete. Another game done. Looking pretty good. This is another little bit of a different style of restoration for me. Just to remind you guys, I'm very new to the restoration game. I haven't been doing it very long at all. So most of the stuff you watch me doing on video more often than not is the first time I'm doing it. Just kind of learning things as I go and having fun doing it. So this particular type of restoration, I guess like keeping it a Survivor. Because this one was all original, like my previous Stargate, if you watched it, wasn't quite all original, was missing some parts, and someone else had restored a few things ahead of time. It seemed like they had changed the control panel, perhaps painted the front, new T-molding, stuff like that. That was a little different. This one is a Survivor because it was just all original. All the original parts are there. The main thing was it wasn't working. I mean, he told me audio wasn't working, but when it arrived, it wasn't working. And it was just filthy, like a mouse was living inside, and you know, it was pretty bad, pretty gross. There was no way I was going to bring it inside the house in that kind of condition. So the plan on this one, I figured it's a perfect candidate to just go keep it a Survivor and just clean it up. And that's what I did. I'd say the only exceptions are, you know, the front coin doors all that paint was bubbling off, and a lot of rust was showing there. I kind of had to paint those. I don't think I had a lot of choice on that. And there was four bolts on the control panel that I ended up painting as well, black because they were rusted. Other than that, I just cleaned the whole thing and got it working again. Yeah, the audio trials and tribulations were pretty funny. I still laugh about that now. Thinking how, I mean, like I mentioned it to a friend of mine. I told him, you know, the audio problem in my mouse trap was that there was a mouse living inside. He told me, well, that's actually to spec then, isn't it? Which is kind of a good point. The mouse trap was functioning correctly as it caught a mouse. So looking pretty good. I like it. Like I said, not perfect. There are scuffs and scratches here and there, but it's pretty good. And I'm happy to have done a survivor. Just to leave it alone, you know, since it's all there, all original. And it looks good enough. If it were damaged more, like seriously gouged, lots of the side art missing and all that kind of stuff, or lots of damage to the marquee, then I would have just done a full restore. But in this case, I think going to the survivor route was the way to go. Pretty cool. One of my favorite games. I'm glad to have it. So why don't I set up the tripod and let's have ourselves a game of Mousetrap. No, actually, you know, before we do fire up a game of Mousetrap, let me
tell the lights here. Forgot to show you guys the game in the dark.
The keyboard, not the keyboard, the control panel does indeed light up. I gotta close my other light, which is pretty cool. I mean, like, it's kind of a day here, so you can see there's a lot of light still flying in. I can't get it completely dark, but, well, you know, here, let me toy with the exposure a little bit. It'll help you see that a bit more. I mean, on the to-do list, one day, I'm going to start looking for LED lights for these, but low-profile ones, the ones I had, simply did not fit. So that's something I can do in the future. Let's get this guy back to the typical exposure. There we go, just to show it in the dark. Anyway, I wanted to show you guys the thing in the dark, how it looks all lit up. And you can see the marquee, actually. We'll get it somewhere there. That probably looks a little bit better. As you see the screen and the marquee, pretty good. All right, cool. Now I'm going to get the thing set up so we can have a game of Mousetrap. Okay, camera set up. I put a quarter in because this game does not have a free play mode. Make sure that's recording. Camera's right over my shoulder. And off we go with Mousetrap, which is basically a Pac-Man clone. But I think a clever Pac-Man clone. At least it's my favorite of the bunch. No offense to fans of Ladybug. That's a great game as well, but this one is just plain cool. When that hawk comes out, you want to hop into that middle thing. It teleports you to one of the four corners, and the hawk loses your trail. It's tough to talk while playing this game, because it's just, you have a Defender-esque style control panel. The hawk's going to come out soon, do the same thing. There's so many controls to manage that it's quite difficult to keep track of everything. Get in there. There we go. Whew. Yeah, you really gotta concentrate this game because you have four buttons and a joystick basically. So it is very much like Defender. The little bonus items, they keep increasing in value as you pick them up until you die. So there's a candlestick you can see up at the top right. Okay, let's hit the dog just so I can get away. Sometimes I'll do that. I'll hit the dog button just so I don't have to worry about the cats so that I can escape. Let's get this area. Because that hawk comes out every few seconds. There should be another one due soon. Ooh, a lot of cats. There we go. Get him. Get in there. Pick up the bonus scissor. Jesus, this thing moves fast. Let's get you. Glass. Oh, I think I'm gonna be screwed here. I don't know if I can get away. Whew. Let's use another bone. You get a lot of bones, so I'm not afraid to use them. Every 30,000 you get a free mouse. I'm gonna have to concentrate here. This is where it starts to get really hectic. Come back here. away, Hawk. Yeah, sometimes it'll teleport you into harm's way, which is not ideal. Man, it is fast at this point. This game gets really hard really fast. But that's what makes it kind of enjoyable in a home environment. At least to me, anyway. That's the shitty part of dying. All your bonus points reset. Oh, I had to use a... no choice. I had to use a bone there. Let's get away from that guy. Wow. Whew. Love this game, even if it makes me seriously stressed out. At this point, you've got a mouse on there that goes faster than you, so you're gonna have no choice but to use I'm totally hosed here. Well, except for some extreme luck. Should be another bird coming soon, I believe. There he is. Yellow. God, I'm confusing the buttons after a while. Oh, doggy. Let's get the martini. Well, martini. Maybe it's a trophy. I don't know what it is. Oh, just a few more to do there. No rest in Mousetrap. Let's just use that. Get that, get that, and... whew! Let's do another free dude. That should give me the free dude. Yes, this thing is going... oh, see, that guy is just faster than you are now. No, oh, crud. Get away, Hawk. Go away. Oh, man, that was the last second mouse right there. Or dog. Let's get the key here. I don't think I can outrun him, can I? Or will we do that? A lot of cats around here. Let's munch them up. And there should be a hawk coming soon. Right there. Let's get you. Oh! Wrong button. I am getting a blister on my joystick finger, believe it or not. Oh, jeez. I think my best is like 170,000 on this game. Something of that nature. Of course, you read the mandatory players that can get millions on these games. I just don't know how some of those guys do. Oh, I gotta use it. That guy is just too fast. Oh. Falling apart. One more maze, I think, would let me get my high score. This guy, that guy's just getting on my nerves. Get away from the hawk. Oh, bonus mouse. That'll help. Oh, I lost my control. Yeah, I'm falling apart. My last mouse. 150. Doesn't look like I'll break my high score. Man, they got me. Well, I mean, decent score, 150. And that, my friends, is Mousetrap. A very fun Pac-Man clone.
Get my name up there.
150. Incredible, according to the game. Anyway, well, I mean, that's Mousetrap. Very fun game. And works real nice. Scroll on back. It looks good, too. Let's get my exposures back to normal. Another game done. Definitely like this game. I was so glad to get it. One of my grail games. Lots of fun. But I'm already getting a little blister on my thumb from using my finger here from using the joystick. That's how hectic this game is. The games are very quick, very fast, very, very, very frantic. But I think that's what makes this game ideal for home use. You're not going to be sitting there playing for a while, at least most people. I'm sure there's some that have mastered this game, but for me, 150 to 170 is about my range. Great game. Anyway, let's wrap this up and head on back up to the office.
And with that, we wrap up yet another game. This time, Mouse Trap. What do you guys think of Mouse Trap? It's one of those rare games. I mean, it's one of those games people look at, and I'm not sure they've seen it before, played it before. As far as I know, those Exidy games are not very common. And they don't tend to come up for sale either, so it's possible a lot of people just have never heard of Mouse Trap. What do you guys think of it? I mean, you can play it on MAME, but it's not the same. I mean, you can kind of get the buttons and all, but it's one of those games that, because of all the buttons and the way it's laid out, is you really need to play it on an original machine, I think, anyway, to get the full feeling for it. But still, try it on MAME, see what you think. I think it's a great Pac-Man clone. I think it's the best Pac-Man clone, really, as you can tell. I mean, I don't like it as much as, let's say, like a Junior Pac-Man or something like that, but it's a very good game, and I'm glad I got it. I'm curious to see what you guys think about my going the Survivor route and not restoring it. I mean, you know, I won't lie, during the whole process that I'm looking at, it's like, it's tempting to, like, you know, I can get the heat gun out, take this side art off, sand this all down, get a nice bright white, throw some pink T-molding on there, paint the rest of it black. It would have looked amazing brand new. I mean, it kind of would have, I'm not going to lie. It was tempting to do that, but I wanted to try doing a Survivor. Like I mentioned previously, most everything you guys are seeing here on video, almost everything, believe it or not, there's a lot of first time I'm doing all this stuff. I'm very, very new to this restoration thing. Restored just a handful of games before I started, you know, videotaping them. So I'm kind of learning as I go. And doing a Survivor, something I hadn't done before. And it seemed like the right thing to do in this case because the whole game was all original and in pretty good condition. So I think that was the right choice. But like I said, if it was very damaged, I would have done a complete restoration on it. But it still looks pretty good, especially in the lineup. I'm very happy with the game. Turned out good. And the whole the whole thing with the audio, that just cracks me up. I mean, I'm still laughing about that. It's just funny because I went through all that effort and planning. Like, I'd never use a Logic Probe or, you know, debug a PCB before. So I'm like, I'm going to do this. I'm going to figure it out. I did all the work and research and looked up chips and tested stuff and a mouse chewed through a cable. Yep, that's all it was. So anyway, at least I'm happy the game works. It works great. Controls are great. And I actually did get some skin removed on my finger on this one right here, which goes kind of on the back side of the joystick. Because you're moving around so frantically in that game. And yeah, I'll have to put the play again. I'm going to have to put a band-aid around. That's all it took before the skin came off. Very hectic game, Mousetrap. Great game. I recommend everyone to play it. And I think on that note, I'm going to wrap up this video. So glad you guys came back. I hope you enjoyed this video, just like my other ones. Check out my other ones too. You'll see me fumbling around through other restores, trying to figure out what the heck to do, learning as I go. Hopefully they're entertaining to you. Well, thanks for watching, and I'll catch you all next time. Bye-bye.